Today's topic is protection of rights of indigenous people under the United Nations Charter. Introduction. The indigenous issues are one of the priorities of the UN and other intergovernmental bodies. The attention to indigenous rights is a constant effort of various UN bodies, indigenous organizations, and organizations working for indigenous peoples. The entry to the term indigenous people to the UN system was through the International Labour Organization, ILO, a specialized global agency which formulated the Convention number 107. That is Convention concerning the protection and integration of indigenous and other tribal and semi-tribal populations in independent territories in the year 1957. This was followed by the UN Subcommission on Prevention of Discrimination and Protection of Minorities, which later became the UN Subcommission on Promotion and Protection of Human Rights of the UN Commission on Human Rights, now we call Human Rights Council, since 2006. The historical evolution of UN Charter. The root of UN Charter can be drawn particularly from the First World War, when the League of Nations was established with the main objective of international peace and security. But the failure to prevent the World War II has strengthened the intergovernmental effort for a better platform. The effort led to the creation of UN Charter and the UN. Some of the significant events that led to the UN Charter are discussed below. Number 1. The Declaration of St. James Palace, 12 June 1941. In June 1941, London was the home of 9 exile governments. The great British capital had already seen 22 months of war. Practically all Europe had fallen to the Axis. At this juncture, the representative of Great Britain, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, Union of South Africa, and the exile government of Belgium, Czechoslovakia, Greece, Luxembourg, Netherlands, Norway, Poland, Yugoslovakia, and General de Gaulle of France met at the ancient St. James Palace and signed a declaration on 12 June 1941. The declaration reflects the initiative for global peace and security. Number 2. The Atlantic Charter, 14 August 1941. 2 months after the London Declaration, President of United States of America, Franklin D. Roosevelt, and Prime Minister of United Kingdom, Winston Churchill, came together for a significant meeting at the Atlantic Sea, where the Battle of the Atlantic was being fought. And on August 14, they issued a joint declaration known as the Atlantic Charter. They declared certain common principles in the national policies of their respective countries on which they base their hope for a better future for the world. Number 3. The Declaration of the United Nations, 1st January 1942. The 26 states, including the USA, UK, China, and USSR, which were at war with the Axis power, subscribes to the common program of purpose and principles embodied in the Atlantic Charter, in a document which became known as the Declaration by the United Nations, containing the first official use of the term United Nations. Number 4. Four Nations Declaration, Moscow Conference, 18 October to 1st November 1943. As part of strengthening the intergovernmental organization, a conference was held at Moscow with the participation of the USA, UK, USSR, and China from 18 October to 1st November 1943. At the conclusion of the conference, the participating government adopted a joint Four Nations Declaration in which, inter alia, they recognized the necessity of establishing at the earliest practicable date a general international organization based on the principles of the sovereign equality of all peace-loving states and open to membership by all such states, large and small, for the maintenance of international peace and security. For the first time, the idea of establishing an international organization to keep the peace after the end of World War II was thus expressly mentioned in an official document. Following the declaration, the four states concerned appointed national committees of experts that separately worked on the drafting of a charter for the future organization. Number 5, Declaration of the Three Powers, Tehran, 1st December 1943. To reaffirm their common policy, President Roosevelt, Prime Minister Churchill, and Premier of USSR Joseph Stalin meet at a conference 28 November to 1st December 1943 in Tehran, and thereby expressing their determination that their nations shall work together in war and in peace. Further, they stated that they will recognize the supreme responsibility resting upon us and all the United Nations to make a peace which will command the goodwill of the overwhelming mass of the people of the world and vanish the scourge and terror of war for many generations. They further announced the intention to seek the cooperation and active participation of all nations, large and small, whose people in heart and mind are dedicated as are our own people to the elimination of tyranny and slavery, oppression and intolerance within a world family of democratic nations. Number 6, Dumbarton Oaks Conference, 21st August to 7 October 1944. The purpose of the conference was to prepare the blueprint for setting up the World Organization. So the representative of the USA, UK met separately with representative of the USSR from 21st August to 28th September, and of China on 29th September to 7 October at Dumbarton Oaks in the context of Washington Conversation on International Peace and Security Organization, or Dumbarton Oaks Conference. The report prepared at a national level by its government following the Moscow Conference was exchanged at the conference. A steering committee was entrusted with reaching agreement on the main substantive issues, and a joint formulation group drafted a text resulting from such negotiation in the form of a treaty. The final document prepared at a conference issued on 9 October 1944 became known as Proposal for the Establishment of a General International Organization, which constitute the initial working document at the San Francisco Conference in 1945. According to Dumbarton Oaks' proposal, four principal bodies were to constitute the organization to be known as the United Nations. There were to be a General Assembly composed of all the members, the Security Council of 11 members, 5 permanent members, and the non-permanent other 6 chosen by the General Assembly to hold office for 2 years. International Court of Justice and a Secretariat. An Economic and Social Council working under the authority of the General Assembly was also proposed. Another important feature of the Dumbarton Oaks plan was the member state were to place armed forces at the disposal of the Security Council in its task of preventing war and suppressing acts of aggression. Number 7, Yalta Conference, 4 to 11 February 1945. The Yalta Conference was mainly on continuing the negotiation on setting up the proposed United Nations. It was attended by President Roosevelt, Prime Minister Churchill, and Premier Stalin. On February 11, 1945, the conference announced the San Francisco Conference. Number 7, Conference of the American Republic, 2nd February to 8 March 1945. The Conference of the American Republic, which was held at Mexico City, supported the Dumbarton Oaks proposal. Number 8, San Francisco Conference, 25 April to 26 June 1945. The United Nations Conference on International Organization was convened in San Francisco from 25 April to 26 June 1945. 50 states participated in the conference at the invitation of the government of USA, UK, USSR, and China. The work of San Francisco Conference was organized as follows. The highest body was a conference plenary sessions, which was in charge of final voting and adoption of the text. Four committees were established alongside the plenary sessions, such as steering committees, executive committees, coordination committees, and credential committees. Beside the plenary sessions and the committees, four general commissions were constituted to coordinate the work of 12 technical committees charged with the preparation of drafting proposal. The commissions are Commission 1, General Provision, Commission 2, General Assembly, Commission 3, Security Council, Commission 4, Judicial Organization. A secretariat was established to provide general administration to the conference. More than 5,000 documents were considered at the conference. A compilation of the principal document was published under the title Document of the United Nations Conference on International Organization San Francisco, Volume 1 to 20, 1945 to 54. Adoption of the UN Charter. The UN Charter, together with the Statute of International Court of Justice, whose form an integral part of the Charter, was adopted unanimously at the end of the conference on 25 June 1945 at the San Francisco Opera House, and was signed the following day at the Herbst Theater Auditorium of the Veterans War Memorial Building. It entered into force in accordance with its Article 110, Paragraph 3 of the Charter on 24 October 1945, following the deposit of the instrument of ratification of the five permanent members of the Security Council and the majority of all other signatories. Structure of the UN Charter. The UN Charter is the outcome of various government and intergovernmental organizations. The Charter gives the minute detail for the establishment of UN organs and the principal objective and its activities. This is to prevent any infamous episodes like the World War and other situations of similar nature. The UN Charter is divided into 19 chapters and 111 articles. Amendments. The UN Charter was flexible enough to amend with the changing socio-political scenario. Article 23, 27, and 61 of the Charter was amended and adopted by the UNGA on 17 December 1963 and came into force on 31st August 1965. An amendment to Article 109, adopted by the UNGA on 20 December 1965, came into force on 12 June 1968. A further amendment to Article 61 was adopted by the UNGA on 20 December 1971 and came into force on 24 September 1973. Indigenous People and UN Charter. The UN Charter not particularly mentioned the rights of indigenous people, as the term indigenous people was introduced in the UN system only after the UN was established. In addition, the establishment of the UN was the main priority of the UN Charter. However, the issues similar to that of indigenous was one of the focus of the UN Charter. For instance, Chapter 11 talks about the declaration regarding non-self-governing territories, Article 73 to 74. Chapter 12 is about international trusteeship system, Article 75 to 85. Lastly, Chapter 13 is also about trusteeship council, Article 86 to 91. These three chapters deal with people living in territories that were non-self-governing, dependent on colonial powers. Their primary responsibility is to guide United Nations decolonization effort, including respect for self-determination of all people through monitoring certain territories, known as trust territories. This initiative could also be considered as a driving force to indigenous people movement, even though it was later separated as a different issue, not as indigenous issues. For instance, when the movement for indigenous rights was gaining momentum, particularly in the early 90s, the activities of trusteeship or the issue of non-self-governing territory was minimized and in some cases ceased to function. Conclusion. The UN Charter is the root of the UN and its major organs such as UNGA, Security Council, ECOSOC, Trusteeship Council, International Court of Justice, and the Secretariat. Besides these major organs, there are various subsidiary organs which are contributing equally to the UN system. In order to avail the facilities and to assert the right, particularly the indigenous people at the UN, we need to know the UN Charter as well as the UN system. The most significant way is to educate the indigenous organization or organization working for indigenous people to reach out to the UN, as the UN, in spite of its expanding activities, is not able to reach out to all the indigenous people who are in need of UN.